Hello students, welcome to the video tutorial of informatics practices of class 12. Today we'll be discussing the second part of the chapter working with NumPy. So let's begin. First topic is NumPy arrays versus Python lists. So what here we'll be doing is we'll be drawing some comparisons between NumPy arrays and Python lists. So let's have a look over the similarity first. Indexing in NumPy arrays is similar to that of lists, which consists of both forward and backward index. 9th class 11th you have studied about list and also about its indexing. So let's see how in arrays we are doing the indexing. Suppose we have an array here with the elements as 5, 6, 7 and 8. So if we talk about the forward indexing, so this will be the direction for the forward indexing. And for the backward indexing, we will be having some negative indexing in this direction. Now let's have a look over the differences, because that is the only similarity between them and in lists and an array. So let's talk about differences now. Unlike lists, once a NumPy array is created, its size can't be changed. Now, since in list we have studied that if a list has already been previously created, we were able to manipulate the size of the list. But here, in case of that array, we are not able to change the size of the array, but we are having two options, either to override the existing array or to create a new one. Also, NumPy array consists of elements of homogeneous types, that is the similar types, and occupies much less space than a Python list. Whereas in list we have studied that all the elements of the list may be of the same type and cannot be the same type as well. So their homogeneity was not an issue. Here in NumPy arrays we have to be very careful about the homogeneity. That means all the elements of the array should be of similar data types. Next point is, NumPy arrays support vectorized operation. Now students, vectorized operation means whenever a function is being performed, it will be performed for each element of the NumPy array. Let's have a look here. Suppose we have a NumPy array here, a1 is equals to np.array 1, 2, 3, 4, and simple a list is given, a is equals to 1, 2, 3, 4. Now suppose we are adding 2 in both the cases, that is in the list and in the array. So the output produced will be, in the first case we will be having an array with the elements as 3, 4, 5, 6. Now you can clearly see that previous array used to consist of the elements as 1, 2, 3 and 4, and now after the performance of the vectorized operation we can see the elements have increased by 2. But here in the list it will produce an error because list cannot have an vectorized operation. Now move on to creating NumPy arrays. For creation of a NumPy array, we need to import NumPy function as import NumPy as np. Now here for creating the NumPy arrays we need a library function known as NumPy, and for using the NumPy in a shorter format we'll be using np here. Now be very careful with this, it is not a strict case to use the np as a short form, we can use any other object name here. Okay, so for our consideration we'll be having the short name as np. The short name is also known as the alias name. So let's create 1d arrays. Following methods are there for creation of 1d arrays. First is the array function. Here it is used for the numeric sequences. Numeric sequences means whatever the sequences will be there will be in the form of numbers. Okay, so let's have an example here. Suppose we have elements 2, 5, 3 Here you can see we have used 5 point there. 5 point symbolizes a float number. Float means a decimal number, whereas 2 and 3 are simple integer numbers. In A2 again we are having that elements only, but the only difference between A1 and A2 is A1 is an array which is being created with the help of list, whereas in A2 we are creating the same array with the help of tuple. Now, since both of the sequences consist of numeric sequences, we can use the array function here. So let's have a look over the second method, that is the fromIter method. fromIter method is used for both numeric and non-numeric sequences. Now you are able to generate the array with the sequences which is either creating a numbers or maybe consisting of some alphabets. So here let's have an example. S is equals to Python. Here you can see S consists of a string named as Python, and if we are going to create the array out of it, we can write a1 is equals to np dot from iter s comma d type is equals to u1. Here d type is equals to u1 means all the elements of the string, when it will be converted in the form of array, will have a length of one Unicode character. So let's see, if you are going to print a1, we will be having the output as python. As you can see, the whole string used to consist of Python as a whole, but now all the elements of that Python string has been separated out in the form of characters. Third method is using arrange. Now arrange here provides a beginning value and the ending value for the array. For example, a1 is equals to np.arrange5. Since here we have not given any initial value, this 5 will be considered as the ending value, and the initial value will be considered as 0 here, that is the default starting value. And in case of A2, we have starting value as 1, stopping index, not the index, it's actually the value here. So a stopping value will be 9 and step is given 2. Now see, if we are using the stopping number or stopping index, we have to stop just one digit earlier. That means here for the first case of A1, we will be having the elements as 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4 in the array, whereas in the second case we will be having 1, 3, 5 and 7. Now why here 1, 3, 5 and 7? Because the starting is 1, but we have to take 2 steps, that is every second element out of that list. So we have got 1 and then we are leaving 2 here, and then we are getting 3, and similarly leaving 4, getting 5, leaving 6, we are getting 7, and the maximum level to go is up to 8, but 8 cannot be considered here because already we have taken 7. So the next element has to be left, and after that we are going to get 9, but 9 has not been taken the stopping index because we have to stop an index earlier. So what you are going to get is array 1, 3, 5 and 7. Now next method is using linspace. Now what it does, it used to provide you again a starting value and ending value, and also you are going to get the number of values evenly spaced between the starting value and the ending value. For example, here if we are given a1 is equals to np.linspace 1, 9, 5, the starting value is 1, stopping value is to be taken 9 here. Be very careful this time, when we are using linspace we have to use the last value as well, that is we have to use here 1 as a starting index and 9 as a stopping value. Be very careful with this. And comma 5 is written, that means we have to separate out 5 values out of it which has to be equally spaced. Similarly, in the second case, a2 is equals to np.linspace, we have to start from 2 and we have to end at 18, and between them we have to separate out 5 values which are equally spaced. So let's have the output here. The first case we'll be having array 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Here you can see it has started from first, that is 1, and stopped at 9, and the values there are 5, and each of them are separated by a gap of 2. Whereas in the second case, again you can see elements have been taken from 2 and stopped at 18, and 5 values have been taken among them, and that all are equally spaced, that is 2, then 6, then 10, then 14, and then 18, that all are having the equal spacing of 4. Now let's move on to creating 2D arrays. Again we are having two functions, using array and using arrange. Let's have an example here. Import numpy as np, a1 is equals to np.array. Now here see, we have started a list, and inside list we are having another list. That is, here we are having an array which is being constructed using a nested list. Okay, and this whole list is considering and consisting of 3 lists as well. So here we'll be having this type of array. That means 1, 2, 3 will be the first row, then 4, 5, 6 will be filled in the second row, and 7, 8, 9 will be filled in the third row. Now suppose we have written a2 is equals to np.a range 1, 10. Since the range is mentioned here, we have to start from 1. We have to stop one number earlier than 10. That means we have to stop at 9. So the elements will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Why? Because here we have not given any step. Because starting index is 1, that is starting value is 1. Stopping value is 10. But no step value is given. So by default, we'll be having the step value as 1. So this array is produced. Now suppose we have to convert the previous given array and this array into a similar form. What we can do is, we can convert this one dimensional array into that two dimensional array in this way. Suppose we write a2 is equals to np.a range 1, 10 dot reshape 3, 3. Now what interestingly this reshape does is it requires the number of rows and number of columns. Here inside the reshape, first element is 3 and the second element is also 3. So the first 3 symbolizes here the number of rows, that is 3 rows should be there. And next 3 symbolizes 3 columns, that is 3 columns should be there. Now what happens if the previous array is to be converted in this form? Again you will be having this type of array. You can see after 1, 2, 3 we have started the new row and we are getting 4, 5, 6, then again 7, 8, 9. So in this way what we have achieved is we have maintained the same number of elements, but now we have got 3 number of rows and 3 number of columns. So whenever you have to create a 2D array from a 1D array, you can use this reshape function. We can also create arrays filled with zeros and ones. For example, here a1 is equals to np.0s 2, 3. So this 0 symbolizes here that all the elements inside this array will be 0, and number of rows and columns are given as 2, 3. That means it should consist of 2 rows and 3 columns. So what will the output is this one. Okay, now again we write a2 is equals to np.1s 2, 3. Now only difference will be there that now all the elements will be 1 and the dimension will remain the same, that is number of rows will be 2 and number of columns will be 3. Now let's move on to array slicing. Array slicing refers to the process of extracting a subset. Now what that does mean that if you are already having an array and you need to extract out some particular elements out of that array, and we should also form an array again, this is called array slicing. Now the format of slicing will be, you have to write the array name first, then the starting, stopping and step value for the rows, and then again starting, stop and step value for the columns. Now in 2D arrays, first the set of rows are to be selected according to the given criteria, that is the start, stop and step. And once the rows are subtracted or extracted, number of columns are to be extracted accordingly. Now see, suppose if you have an example here, array 1 colon 4 colon 2, you can see it has to start from 1, you have to stop one index earlier, that is up to 3, and then you have to take every second row. Now you can see in this example, the comma is separating the extraction between the rows and the columns. Now before the comma, whatever part will be there, it will be considered for rows, and after the comma, whatever the part will be there, it will be considered for the columns. Now you can see here, starting value is 1 colon 4 colon 2, that means for rows you have to consider the first row, then since step is given 2, you have to consider the every second column, then you will get 3, and since the stopping value is given 4, we cannot go further, so only 1 and 3 will be considered here. And now after extraction of that rows, you will move forward in the columns, and in the columns you will be having the starting index as 2, stopping index will be 6 minus 1, that is 5, and every second column is to be considered. Now we will be clearing it further in details in the next slide. Suppose if you are having this also, another example, array colon 5 comma colon colon minus 1. Now what is happening here, that before the comma only one thing is given, colon 5. So the starting value is not mentioned for the rows. Stopping value is mentioned is 5. So we have to take one index less than 5, that is up to 4. And again no step value is given for this. So the by default step value will be 1. So what we will be selecting here for rows is 0 index of row, then 1, then 2, then 3, then 4. But we cannot consider 5 because we have to take one index less than this. Then row is extracted, and then we have to move for the columns. So in columns also, you can see after the comma, it is nothing mentioned about the starting value, nor there is a mention of the stopping value, only the step value is given. So what we will do here, we'll consider all the columns here, no column index is mentioned, because so only the negative index of step or the negative value of step is to be taken. Now what negative step will do here, it will write all the elements in the reversed order. If you are not able to understand now, we'll be having another slide to make it more clearer. Suppose we have an array here. Here you can see number of rows is 4 and number of columns is 5. See, this is symbolizing the rows and this is symbolizing the columns. Now we have provided the index according to the forward and backward indexing for rows and also for the columns. Now see, for creating this array, we can write the code like this: import numpy as np, a is equals to np dot a range, 1,21 dot reshape 4,5. So the np dot a range 1,21 will create array from the elements 1 to 20, and this reshape will convert it into a 2D array with number of rows as 4 and the number of columns as 5. Now if you see, a1 is equals to a 0,1,5. Here you can see comma is for separating the extraction of rows and columns. So before comma only 0 is mentioned, no column is mentioned, because if any colon is not there, be very careful for this, I'm talking about the colon. If any colon is not mentioned, So we can say only the starting value of the row index is given. That means what we have to consider here, only the zeroth row, that is row number 0. So that is actually the row number 1, because indexing will start with the 0. So we will be having the first row in this. And now if we are talking about columns, so after comma we are having 1:5, that is starting index for the column will be considered as 1, and stopping index of the column will be 5 minus 1, that is 4. So what we have to do here, we have to separate out this yellow slice. As you can see in this yellow slice, the starting column index is 1 and it is ending at 4, that is 1 less than 5. And since we have only mentioned 0 in the row, so the first row will be only considered. So whatever will be the yellow slice, it will be sliced out because of the A1. Now similarly, if we see the A2, A2 is mentioned as A1:4, 0:3:2. Now here what we can see, the starting value for the row is given as 1. So we have to start from the row index 1. We have to go to third index because 4 is mentioned here. So what we will be taking the rows as row number 1, row number 2 and row number 3. And for the columns, we have to start from column index 0. Then we have to take the step as 2. So what we'll be doing here, we'll be considering the every second column. So column number 0, that is, then we have to take the second column, means leaving the second column, we'll go to the column number 1. And since the maximum level is up to 3, so only we can consider these two columns, that is column number 0 and column number 2. So whatever is mentioned in the red slice, this will be the output for the A2. Similarly, if we are writing A3 as A-1:4, 3:, so again first we will consider about the row index. For the rows it is mentioned as -1:-4. So if we take the negative index of the rows, so the -1 row is to be considered, then -2 is to be considered, and then -3 is to be considered, and we will not consider the -4 because we have to stop one step earlier. Now again for the columns, we can see it is written as 3:, so the starting value for the columns will be column number 3, and then we have to go for all the columns because nothing is mentioned for the stopping value of the columns. And also no step is given, so by default all the steps will be 1. So we will start from column number 3, then we will go to column number 4. But since all the columns are over here, so we cannot go beyond this. So whatever we will be having is the gray slice, as you can see in the diagram. So students, if you have not able to understand this properly, we will be having another video tutorial with the further more examples for array slicing. So try to create some examples of your own and solve it. We'll be having a next lecture over this. Thank you.